If you want to pump your body and expand your mind, there's only one place to go. Mind Pump. Mind Pump. With your hosts, Sal DiStefano, Adam Schaefer, and Justin Andrews.
In this episode of Mind Pump.
Mind the pumper.
For the first 20 minutes, Justin, Adam, and I had to correct that, by the way.
Oh, God.
Every other time.
Don't get me started with
that
shit.
I say me, Adam, and Justin.
And I.
Improper English. Mm. Justin, Adam, and myself have some fun conversation in the intro. We talk about our LA interview marathon. Nobody can podcast harder than Mind Pump.
We podcast hard.
Then we talk about my son's robotic competition. I actually was building some relationships with some of the kids, trying to hedge my bets because I know we're going to have some future.
In case my son can
be the next Steve Jobs.
Exactly. Yeah. I'm trying to figure that out there.
I'm recruit that kid.
We talk about my new deodorant. It's Royal and Rogue scented pit paste that I found on Thrive Market. Thrive Market.
You smell like an off-putting king.
It has some of the best prices you'll find on organic, non-GMO products, both foods and cosmetic products. You'll actually get a massive discount, by the way. All you got to do is go to thrivemarket.com/mindpump. You'll get 1 month for free of the membership. You'll get $20 off your first three orders of $49 or more, and you'll get free shipping. We also mention Organifi, which is our other sponsor. Actually, Justin was eating all the cookies.
Finally brought them.
Hell yeah. I get hungry.
Yeah, lots of good macros there, huh, Justin?
Yeah.
You're in the bulk again?
Always.
Organifi.
Steady bulking.
OrganifiShop.com. Enter the code MINDPUMP, and you'll get, I think, 20% off. Then we get into the questions. The first question was, what do we recommend that people compete if they've already had hormonal issues? So let's say somebody's had thyroid issues or has had issues with irregular menses, if they're a woman. Should they compete in competitions like bikini or figure or bodybuilding? Find out in this episode. The next question was, how do we think the holidays affect our mental and physical health? And what do we recommend for people so that they can stay in a routine during the holidays?
Find out why I don't give a shit.
Find out why Adam wants people to buy him toilet paper.
Bah humbug.
Not joking. The next question was, have our recent CrossFit guests changed our minds?
Or is Justin still bitter?
About CrossFit.
Yeah.
He's so bitter.
CrossFit.
And finally, we share some of our most embarrassing sex stories.
This is where it gets weird.
There's some horrible ones in there. Also, by the way, stay tuned to the end of this episode. We're introducing a new segment once a week. At the end of the episode, you are going to get a knowledge bomb. It's like a 3 or 5 minute knowledge bomb. You won't want to miss it, so stay tuned until the very end. Also, we have, obviously, fitness programs that we design and that we sell. They're the best fitness programs on the market. We know this because we've done studies on them ourselves. They're called MAPS programs. One MAPS program in particular is probably the one that we recommend the most for the holidays. It's actually a bundle. It's called the Sexy Athlete Bundle. It combines MAPS Performance, which is very functional in nature, with MAPS Aesthetic, which is more designed for your aesthetic-based individuals. We've taken both programs, combined them with expert programming. It's if you combine the two and you program it out, you're looking at about, I don't know, 5 months of exercise program. So it'll take you right through the holidays, all the way up until your New Year's resolution, making you look awesome in 2018. Find out more about the Sexy Athlete Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com.
Hashtag salad tosser.
That didn't work out.
All right, it hashtag is t-shirt time.
Give away some shirts.
Holy shit.
How many reviews, Doug?
20 reviews.
Let's rip this out.
Shit. We're
giving away six shirts. So first up is M. Madden 35, Sluggermeister.
Great.
Hey, Sluggermeister. Zen Doggy, Nancy D, Sioux Fall Kids. All of you are winners. Send the name I just read to iTunes@mindpumpmedia.com, your shirt size, your shipping address, and we'll get that right out to you.
You guys did it!
Dude!
I
am extremely proud of us.
Were you guys exhausted or what?
No.
Yeah.
You got up at 8 o'clock or earlier on Sunday.
Got up at 8 o'clock.
Yeah.
No, dude. I had to get up at... So, just so we have a little context for the audience, we went to L.A. and did 10 podcasts in 3 days with a bunch of different guests. I think we invented the hashtag podcast hard. Yeah. I don't know if it's. I will own that.
It didn't exist.
We podcasted to failure.
I definitely invented it. Yeah.
We did. We did phase one to failure podcasting.
We had that moment when we were talking to JJ, who was the very last podcaster that we were with, and we were talking about. We were just all talking about the importance of balance and health and this and that. And all I'm thinking to myself is like, dude, I'm so fried right now.
Overworked.
Yeah, so fried.
Dude, right? What a great lineup we had. Let's start from the beginning. We met with Lewis House. Mm-hmm. Great dude,
Louis.
Great dude. You know, sometimes you meet people who are successful. And it's a letdown because they're idiots. This was not the case with Lewis House.
He's a hugger.
First of all, he's a hugger. Yeah, that's true.
He rubbed my shoulder.
He's a long hugger. Yeah. Like you can't if you.
He did embrace. It's not a hug. It's an embrace.
Yeah.
He's like genuinely friendly.
Did you guys get a chest circle? I got a chest.
No, I got a shoulder circle.
I got a crotch grab. So. I don't know.
That's different.
But super smart guy. Very just genuine. Nice dude. Great podcast, which already dropped. So I'm sure people have already listened to that. Mm. Then where do we go straight from there? We went from there to, was it Bradley Martin?
Yeah, Bradley was next.
Yeah.
We met with Bradley Martin, who, if you're not familiar with who he is.
This is going to be so epic. I don't even want to share much about this
one. No giveaways.
When that episode drops and people listen to it, they're going to be like, what?
Yeah.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Let's just say.
We're coming in hot.
Let's just say a few minds were blown and things were shattered in terms of perceptions and whatnot. So. Wait for that one. And then who was the third person that day?
Robert Oberst.
Yeah. Robert Oberst. He's
what a cool
world's
dude.
Strongest
dude,
man
he's
competitor.
Hilarious. Yeah, it was fun talking to him.
He's just a huge human being.
He was one of my favorite too because I probably did the least amount of homework on him coming into this.
Mm.
And so
he's a natural.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. He's after we hung up the mics, we all talked to him about doing his own show. I'm like, man, you've got great, great charisma. He's funny.
Great stories.
Yeah. And he's a fucking badass.
I just forget that humans come in that size. I always forget every time I see someone
like that. With John
Dude,
Jones.
He picked up Adam like Adam was a child.
Oh, yeah. God, that was so
He literally
funny.
Put you in his arms like a baby.
We're taking a photo before we leave, and Doug says, hey, let's do something fun. And right away, he just like scoops up underneath my butt and just poop.
Yeah. You look like a little kid.
Like a little kid.
Adam's eye. He looked up. Did you see what Adam did? He looked up at him and he's like with the big
instantly
eyes.
My thumb just went in my mouth.
Like stars. Like,
And then the next day, we start off the next day with Brendan Schaub.
Yeah.
Right?
Oh, man.
Fun.
We've been wanting to do that one forever.
Brendan Schaub is, he's one of the hosts of Fighter and the Kid podcast, one of our favorite podcasts we've been talking about since
big
we started
Brown
my
Breakdown. Oh, yeah. They're hilarious.
Very smart guy, very funny guy, great storyteller. So we had a good time there. And then who came after him? It was Brendan Schaub.
Then drama.
Chris Pfaff. How do you say his last name? Pfaff? Pfaff.
Yeah.
How do you Pfaff? Pfaff.
Actually, no, it was Rich Roll before Chris.
Oh, it was Rich Roll.
So that's right. Brendan, Rich Roll.
And then it was Chris Pfaff.
How about Rich's house, man?
Dude. He has his own little compound.
It's an awesome place.
It's a trip. You know what? It's like what tripped me out. I was trying to explain to Katrina. I'm all typically I would like it, but it's like super.
It's my kind.
It's like modern.
Yeah, it's modern meets hippie.
Chic. Yeah,
it's modern meets hippie. That's what's kind of weird about it.
I hate
it.
That word chic. What are
you? You could see me living in a place like that.
Yeah, I could see that. For sure.
Yeah, so
he's like a lap pool.
He had converted. This is kind of cool. He converted these.
What are those called?
I know I can't.
No, they're not portables.
No,
shipping containers.
Yeah, shipping containers.
There you go.
He had converted two shipping containers. One of them is his kid's bedroom, right? So one of his kid's bedroom is a shipping container.
It's like a shoebox.
Then he has an office that's a shipping container. So, and then he's got this like multi-million-dollar home on the top of the Hollywood Hills that's just overlooking the area. It's absolutely amazing.
Gorgeous, gorgeous.
He was really cool.
He was cool. Yeah. And then, of course, drama was awesome. Another person that completely
surprised us. I think.
So, well, he surprised me because I didn't know enough. I didn't know a lot about him. Now I knew him from Robin Big, and he's extremely intelligent dude. Very, very smart guy. Very smart in business. Again, another very charismatic person. He has his own podcast, and that was the second day. Then the third day, we got interviewed by Liz from the podcast at Univision.
Right.
Always, we love
always
her. We love
time.
You, Liz.
Yeah.
Great, great. And then we had Christina from Actually Adultish podcast.
She is such a little badass.
Little
Spitfire.
Dude, here's the thing about
first guess, first person ever to interview Mind Pump and like be able to wrangle us and talk over us,
we're,
dude.
We're impossible like to do that.
And talk shit to us.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was great. That's the tough thing about interviewing us is as soon as we go, you gotta just give up the podcast. Like, here you go. Yeah,
like, there
and
it is.
No, she wrangled us a bunch of times. She's a little hustler. She's awesome.
Yeah. And what, then 22 years old.
Mm-hmm.
I really enjoy talking to her just because we talk a lot, and I know sometimes if there's anything that you know, that I think we have a bad habit of is speaking to ourselves, meaning like, you know, what we would want to hear, you know, the 35 to 38 year old versions of us.
What, bodybuilder directed.
Whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's just stuff that we're currently dealing with interest. Yeah. Or what we see in the industry because of what we're looking at, where, you know, coming from a 22-year-old's perspective who pretty much was born and raised with Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all this stuff like that, and to hear what it's like, and food blogging, and so to hear her perspective in the same industry was very unique. And how cool is that? She talks about, she interviewed a 7-year-old girl she had on her show. I thought, that's really...
Yeah. I'm going to look for that interview.
That was very interesting for her to do that. And I thought that was pretty neat that she shared that. I thought that was really cool.
Super smart girl.
Mm-hmm. If you guys had to pick, and I know this is not fair.
Don't be an asshole.
No.
If you had to pick your two personal favorites, who and why?
Favorites?
Yeah. Not the favorite people, favorite interview. Like, what? Like,
well, I know the audience is going to be most blown away by Bradley Martin's. I can pretty much guarantee that. By his interview. And I don't want to go too much into it. I don't want to ruin it. But it was shockingly different than what I anticipated. So I know the audience, if when they're listening, they're not going to...
Yeah, but I don't want to hear what you think that what's going to do
yeah,
go
like,
the
well,
most viral.
Me, the audience
what was your personal two favorite and why?
I like Brendan Schaub was definitely one of my favorites just because I've followed them for a long time. I've heard, you know, multiple shows with them, and just to have that sort of rapport in the podcast itself was great. He told great stories. I thought we were really on fire on that episode. I think that's going to be a great one. And on top of that, like you guys mentioned, the what's her podcast again? The
Addicted to Love.
Addicted to Love.
Her podcast is actually Adultish.
Yeah. I really enjoyed it. Mm-hmm. I just felt like we were ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, and I haven't felt like that as we were being interviewed by anybody before. So I got to give her some love for that. For
I'm not going to. I think I'll say that. I'll say her too. And then the other one's a tough one. I'm still going to say Bradley Martin because it shocked me. You know, he opened up quite a bit. His crew is really cool. Great gym. We had a lot of fun. Could have gone forever on that podcast. We had another person scheduled, so we had to leave. But I think we recorded like a 2-hour podcast with him. That could have easily been a 3 or 4.
Oh, especially once the weed started going around. Oh, once that started going around, it was no slowing us down for sure. I'm gonna for sure Bradley Martin. Just because I've followed him since the very beginning, and you guys will dig it too about something that him and I kind of got into midway through the podcast. I thought was pretty funny.
Oh yeah, that was classic,
right? So that one for sure is one of my favorites. And I just think he's a cool dude, and I think that there's a lot more to him, and I just see kind of where he's at right now. I thought that was neat, and I loved that, you know. And this always happens to us, you know. If you don't know or you don't listen to Mind Pump, when we go to interview some of these people, it's, you know, a lot of these guys, especially at this level, are so fucking busy. They're not listening to every Mind Pump episode. They don't know everything that we're sharing or we're talking about. They don't know a lot about us. Most people do a little bit of homework, and then it's like, okay,
here we go,
right? And you can always feel the energy in the room when someone doesn't really know us, and you can just tell they're assuming, you know, whatever they're assuming, whether they think you're a bunch of bros or you know, we're assholes or we're cock, whatever. I don't even know what's going through their head. I just know it's not a comfortable feeling for everybody, and it's the funniest thing ever because there's this moment of awkwardness before we start.
Mm-hmm.
You know, not really making eye contact, not really talking very much, just like, okay, we're gonna do this.
Where's this going?
And then the mics come on, and then you can watch the energy shift and change. Bradley, to me, was one of the biggest that I saw that shift with. Mm-hmm. And then the second one, and that's why I'm picking this as my second one, was Drama.
Drama, yeah.
Because Drama, I felt, and Brianna even told me that when she booked it, that he was really hesitant to do the show with us because he's like, I don't really know anything about fitness. He was so concerned that we were going to take him in a fitness direction and talk nothing but working out and macros and that, and she kept saying that, no, you just wait till you meet the boys. Just wait till you meet the boys. You know, that you're going to like them. And so when we got to his office, he was still on a conference call. But really what it felt like was just like, oh, I just don't want to do this interview. And we're just kind of sitting there, Doug's setting up. And I'm like waiting for him to come into the podcast
room. I was like, okay, here we go.
Yeah.
And talk to these meatheads.
And then I felt like that when he first came in. And then about, I don't know, 15 minutes or 20 minutes in the interview, you could tell the energy completely shift. Yeah. And then, you know, Bradley, you know, it's always awesome. We were on a crazy tight schedule.
So many people.
Yeah, we were on a tight schedule.
Gotta love the 180.
When you see them flip like that and to the point where they're like looking at you like, oh, we can keep going, and like following us out to leave, and we're like, oh, we gotta go to the next interview. We're so sorry. Like, we gotta do this again.
Yeah, it was awesome.
Yeah.
So. It was super awesome. So we did all that. We get home. We arrive like at what, 9? You know, go to bed late because I'm still buzzing. Next morning I wake up 6 a.m. because it's my son's robotics tournament. So they have this big robotics tournament that they do every year. They got fifth place, unfortunately. So they didn't qualify for regionals this time.
Man, but those are some sophisticated robots.
Dude, so
send me pictures.
So here's the thing. Like, I'm sitting there and I'm watching all these kids who are designing these robots to perform these tasks. I mean, here's what it is. Keep in mind, this is from kids who are in fifth and sixth grade all the way up to 14-year-old kids, different varying degrees of skill and difficulty or whatever. These kids are given tasks. There's like, I don't know how many tasks, 20 tasks, and you can try doing all of them or you could try only doing some of them. And the tasks range from, you know, pick this block up over here and put it over there to put these two pieces together to hit the switch or whatever. And it has to be all autonomous. You have to, and they don't give you any other instructions other than that. So you have to build a robot from scratch. You have to design what it's going to look like, how it's going to move.
Yeah.
Then you have to program it, and you got to look at these programs these kids write. It looks like, I don't know how the fuck they know what they're doing. I'm looking at these programs like, this is crazy. You push a button, and the robot does what it does, and you can look at the different robots from the different teams. None of them look the same at all. They all look different. They all have different attachments, different arms. So crazy. And then there was the high school robotics team, which obviously isn't competing in this one because they're too old, but the high school robotics team then had displays of what their robots look like. And one of the robots that was built by this high school was a t-shirt cannon. So they built a t-shirt cannon that now they bring to the football games, and it's kind of like a mascot, and they drive around the field and they blast.
That's badass.
And it's like, it's got the fucking, you know, it's got the compressed, you know, oxygen or whatever that is, CO2, and it rides around and it aims and freaking
blasting people.
Dude, these kids are crazy. Yeah. I love the whole environment. But anyway, I was there from 8 a.m. to 7 or 8 p.m.
Oh my God.
Yeah, dude. It was pretty, but it was exciting.
That long, huh? Is it like multiple rounds? How does it work?
So there were 40.
How do you get fifth place? Like what's the criteria?
So there were 40 teams that competed.
Oh wow.
So
fifth out of 40 is not a big deal.
Well,
said fifth, like it was like, oh man.
Well, because he didn't qualify for regionals, but there was 40 teams. You get points for all these different tasks, and you get some points if you do a little bit of them. You get full points if you do all of them. Then there's bonus points, and then you get penalties if you have to touch your robot while it's still in play. So let's say it trips over something, turns over, or
you have to like readjust,
or your program didn't fucking work right, and you got to grab it and place it back to the starting point. Mm-hmm. You get a 5-point deduction. You can get deductions for a few different things. So at the end of it, you get your total score, and then based on that score, it determines where you rank in this particular competition. But then you also get judged on robot design. Then they also have to do presentations where there's a theme. For the competition, for this competition, the theme was water, like water conservation. So the kids also have to come up with their own designs and ingenious ways of, you know, how to save water. So like my son's team came up with a way of using gray water. Gray water is the water that comes from your shower and when you wash your hands and stuff. And they came up with a way for it to be circled around so that you could use it in your toilets so that you don't have to use the same, you know, you're not wasting a bunch of extra water. Mm. And so kids come up with different ways of, you know, conserving water, and they have to present that. Then they have to present like what's called core values and all these different things. And
so amazing.
Again, I'll tell you what, I'm so proud right now, my kid. First of all, I'm proud because leading up to this, their practices are going till 7 or 8 o'clock at night. So not only did he go to school Thursday, Friday, and they practice 2 or 3 days a week until 5 p.m. anyway. But leading up to the tournament, they're doing like a lot of work. So my kid is in school, and then he finishes school, and then he's working on robotic stuff until 8 p.m. And then he has to go home and do his homework. So he did this like 2 or 3 nights in a row. Then he did the whole tournament. Poor kid was so tired this morning. He looked like a zombie. You know, I was like basically feeding him his breakfast because he's so tired. But he had another leadership moment that I was so proud of. They do a practice round in the beginning where the first round doesn't count and every team gets to do this practice round. And one of the obstacles was reversed. One of the Lego obstacles was backwards when in comparison to how they've been practicing at school. So obviously the robot couldn't perform the task and they did horribly. And so the kids are kind of crapped out and they're going back. And my son's like, that, I don't remember which one it was, the water obstacle, whatever. He goes, that was backwards. He goes, it was backwards. It wasn't right. So he goes back, starts talking with his team. And I'm just observing. I'm like, at first I'm like, what? I'm like, you say, but I didn't say anything. I said, I'm not gonna say anything. See what happens. So he talks with his team and then him and one of the other kids goes up to the judges, which is intimidating. These are all like big judges or whatever. Walk over and they come up with their laptop and I can see my son and this kid talking to the judge and I can see the judge kind of arguing with them and they're going back and forth and then the judge goes and looks at the table and this and that. Remember, these are the, all the, these are the four tables that are set up, roped off, like you can't go near them or whatever. Mm-hmm. He goes over, looks at him and he's like, and he shakes his head and then he goes over and he flips the thing over and I go talk to my son, like, what happened? He goes, yeah, they messed up. They had it on backwards. Fuck yeah, dude. You went over there and got them, straightened them out, you know what I mean? And got it all fixed, but you had the, you know.
How many kids are on a team?
Depends on the team. Some have as little as 3 or 4, some as many as like 7 or 8, depending on the school. There were all girls teams. A lot of the teams were co-ed. My son's team is just boys because they have a girls team at the same school. So just super awesome, dude. Really, really cool stuff. And it's cool to see these kids because you know that you learn so many skills from life skills from any sport or competition, right? That you're in. I mean, anybody who's played sports, you guys talk about this all the time, the life skills that you learn. Mm-hmm. But the thing about the robotics that I really like is I'm looking at this and I'm like, holy shit, these are like work skills too.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's applicable.
Yeah, yeah, it's like super applicable. In fact, Google and Tesla and Apple.
They're already there scouting.
No, not only that, they have their own, like some of these top level tournaments for robotics happen at Google.
Of course.
You know those motherfuckers are scouting these kids.
Of course.
Yeah.
How funny is that, dude? Like
that early, dude. Of
course. Already scouting.
That's great.
Damn.
Man.
Isn't that crazy?
That is crazy.
Yeah. Anyway, so you guys are going to ask me why I smell so good? I kept rubbing my armpits in your face.
Yeah, what is
you
that?
Guys, you guys are getting pissed off.
You know what?
Less hippie.
I know. I wanted to get
it. I give you a lot of crap all the time about not smelling really good, and you actually do smell really good. What are you working
you
on
You guys
over
are
there?
Trying to figure out why I kept rubbing my face.
I actually thought it was Doug at first, and then I realized, oh, that's Sal who's
it's
got
me,
the good.
Bro.
What you got?
The scent is
the aroma.
The scent is royal and rogue. That's the name of the scent.
What?
That's the name of the so
Royal.
I use this,
what is it?
I use this,
is it lotion or is it
No. So I use a natural deodorant called Pit Paste.
Which normally sucks, I'm telling
no,
you.
No, it doesn't. Stop. There's only one time, bro, where you smelled me, and I need to fucking talk about this forever.
You smell great though now, dude.
Yeah, right. So anyway, it's Pit Paste is the name of it. It's all organic. It's made with shea butter.
Oh, that's what you're wearing right now.
Yeah, baking soda.
What were you wearing before? There was something you were wearing before.
There was one day, it was the time, it was when we were doing the presentation.
Orange Theory.
Orange Theory, where I didn't wear any deodorant and I was nervous.
Uh-oh.
And then I had to run across the street and I did something really bad. I actually put deodorant on and then didn't buy the deodorant.
Yeah.
You did not.
I was there. I witnessed that.
I did, bro. I went to the store and put it on. And then left I don't know why I did that. I got a thrill out of it.
Somebody had a bad day.
Yeah.
You know?
But anyway,
I need some deodorant.
So Pit Paste I bought off on our sponsor, Thrive Market, for $7, normally $10 or $11. So there you go. If you want natural deodorant,
okay,
I recommend it.
It's all natural.
It's completely natural. There's no aluminum in it, which is not good. Aluminum in your deodorant, not a good thing. Definitely don't buy any antiperspirants. And then most of them, you know, what you put on your body is what goes in your body. It's right. really not that different from when you eat something. I mean, which it is different, but it's not.
Adds up. I mean, that's one of those things you start thinking about, and I've started to do that too, and like shampoos and soaps and deodorants, all these things. It's like all these chemicals are just bombarding yourself with constantly. It's the chronic, you know, constant bombarding of it that's the issue.
What happens when I talk about this with people, then I get the whole like, oh, everything's bad for me.
I know.
You know, the
sky is falling.
The reality is, the stuff you put in your mouth, as shitty as it can be, is far more regulated than the stuff you put on your body. Way more. Mm. Way more regulated than the stuff you could put on your body or spray in your hair.
Which makes sense because it's more dangerous, right? I mean, obviously, if you're swallowing something, it's a little more dangerous than probably putting it on your skin.
Well, dude, like feminine hygiene products, that we've talked about this before, like tampons and stuff, they are, you know, made out of cotton. The cotton that's in a tampon is regulated very different. It's regulated as a textile, I believe. But it's literally inside your body, and it's like full of chlorine, full of pesticides and other things, and women are putting it in their, you know, their vag or whatever, and it's absorbing.
or whatever.
I don't know. Or
wherever, whatever else you're cooter, but I was like trying to keep it classy.
We can say vagina.
We're still 13. I can't say vagina. I don't know why. I got to say a stupid word.
It's so clinical.
Yeah,
it's like, ew, yeah. I want to make it sound pretty.
Yeah, anyway.
Yeah.
Bring on the bird, Douglas.
This quaz brought to you by Organifi. For those days you fall short on getting your organic veggies or whole food nutrition, Organifi fills the gap with laboratory-tested, certified organic superfoods to help give your health and performance the added edge. Try Organifi totally risk-free for 60 days by going to Organifi.com. That's Organifi.com. And use the coupon code MINDPUMP for 20% off at checkout.
All right, our first question is from Naudi Gagnon, 14. Would you recommend competing for a person who has had hormonal issues in the past, such as thyroid issues and amenorrhea, etc.?
Oh, definitely not.
Totally not.
Yeah.
Totally not.
Especially not. I mean,
it's one of the worst things you could do for your hormones if you're healthy.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. No, I mean, you would have, this has, okay, so even like when we talked to Robert Otis the other day, right, when he was sharing like, you know, the way he was eating and training is like, you know, if you have this, like, you know, you're fucking your body up and you just don't care it, then you want to sacrifice it for the sport because you love the sport so much, then who am I to judge you, right? So sure. That's kind of how I answer somebody who asked me a question like this. Like, I mean, if you grew up your whole life like aspiring to be a bodybuilder or want to get into competing because it's like you're all into that, I could totally understand that. And you just know that that is not the ideal thing that you should be doing hormonally to your body. And if you already have past issues, mm-hmm. This is probably going to exaggerate them. But who am I to tell you can't do that? So
they're just asking to recommend.
Right, yeah. I mean? Yeah. But it's a no-brainer. Like, no, if you came up, if you were calling me up and thinking about hiring me, I'd be like, yeah, you shouldn't do this.
Yeah, probably not a good fit for you.
No.
I mean, it just seems like common sense. But, you know, I think people still think that's like a healthy representation still. And so then, you know, well, you know, I've had issues, but, you know, maybe I should still go through
this
that
process.
This
will get
process. Me fit. Yeah.
Yeah, no.
It'll get me fit. Yeah.
No. So I also want to say the statement here, men and women are very different in this
mm-hmm,
regard.
Mm-hmm.
They're very different. The male body is far, far more resilient
yes.
to calorie restriction and extreme exercise than the female body is, in the sense that the female body, when you're looking at things like, you know, quote unquote metabolic damage, hormonal dysfunction, all that stuff, it really affects women.
I know
more, much more.
I know
way.
More women that have fucked up their metabolism from competing than I know men.
It's just, here's the thing, like
like more than double.
Here's what you want to understand. Let's say you're a female and you want to get lean and shredded for a bikini or figure competition, and you do everything right, everything, like, and what I mean by right is, you know, you're hiring the right coach, you're doing the right amount of exercise, you're eating, you know, the right amount of food, but you're still getting your body fat down to single digit body fat percentage. Still not good for you.
Right.
Regardless of how you do it. Now, of course, you can do it a lot worse by doing things the wrong way and really fucking shit up. But even if you do it right, the female body responds to being extremely lean in a very negative way. Because the female body, you know, evolved to bear a child or to, you know, produce life or whatever, whereas a male body just needs to produce sperm. Two completely different requirements on the body. And if you get too lean, even if you do it right or whatever, I mean, amenorrhea is when you get menstrual irregularities. Right. So period stops.
Which is extremely common in women's bikinis.
Oh, dude, it's going to happen.
Yeah, it's almost guaranteed. Like most women will tell you that, like when you do it, like, oh yeah, you're going to lose your period.
That's right.
Yeah.
One of the measures of hormonal health for a woman, one of, because there's many of them, but one of the things that you can look at to see if your hormones are imbalanced for your body is your menses. The, you know, how heavy your period is, how long it lasts, how severe your PMS symptoms may be, whether, you know, you're regular or every month it's a different, it looks like sometimes your cycle's 45 days and sometimes it's 15 days or whatever. Those are really good signs that your hormones aren't necessarily balanced for your body. And it's one of the first things to get fucked up when your diet, you know, you're competing for a show. So definitely don't recommend this for anybody who's had hormonal issues. And if you're healthy, expect hormonal issues. Expect hormonal issues from competing. Now, this doesn't mean that you can't compete, get changes in your hormones, and then kind of rebuild and fix them, because you can.
Yeah.
But everybody, anybody, okay, and I'll dare anybody to do this if you're natural. Test your hormones when you're, normal working out, normal dieting, you know, relatively lean but not shredded, just healthy. And then test your hormones right before your competition. And I guarantee they're going to be very different. Mm-hmm. No matter what, they're very, very different.
That would have been a fun thing for me to do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I wish I would have done that.
Yeah. And men experience this as well. It's just we tend to bounce back a little better. But even for a man, doing this too often, you get you'll get issues with testosterone and cortisol as well.
You're redlining this whole time. I mean, it's an extreme. You gotta like keep that in perspective.
Well, that being said, okay. So, and we're talking about this person right here with all these issues. But a healthy, normal person, okay. When I competed, you know, part of what kind of helped my social media grow was sharing this process, right? My transformation process. And I would share with people too that you don't have to make yourself into a martyr to get to that lean either. So that's what's partially wrong with competing is the culture. The culture has turned into this thing where you have to like abuse your body to get to that point. And it's, you know, beast mode, no days off, and it's the 2 days of cardio and the super low calorie. Like, no, you can actually, and restricting water and sodium and. Yeah. There's a lot of things that's like misrepresented, and there's definitely a better way to do this. And I remember it was not until probably the last 10 days did I start talking, and I remember sharing this on YouTube and saying like, listen, this is at this point, here's where the real sport of it comes in. Up until this point, it's just making.
But that's not, yeah, like you did that way, which is great because you've been able to highlight that we can sort of limit this down to more like a 10 or day or like a 2 week sort of like super intensity, like leading up to it. Whereas everybody else kind of going into this, yeah, it's the whole 12 weeks.
Yeah, I look at the same way of training for like a professional, any other professional sport, right? Like if you're hammering your body,
you want to peak it.
Yeah, exactly. You want to peak at game time, and that's when you are. So I think there's a lot of people, a lot of coaches given really bad information. So that's the scary part and why I think right away everyone's quick to be like, no, don't do this. But, you know, I mean, I got all the way down to, you know, 3%, and 3% is not a healthy place to stay. And I didn't stay there very long. I mean, within a week, I was already back up 4 or 5% body fat real quick. You know, not a lot of people can sustain, you know, single digit or low single digit body fat for a long period of time. And especially not women. Right.
Let me ask you this, Adam, because you have a lot of experience with this. Let's say, and this is going to be a general question, so I know it depends, but let's say you have a person doing everything right, dieting right, exercising right, and competing. How many shows do you think they should limit themselves to per year?
Ooh, that's a really good question. That, you know why that's such a good question is because just now, like I think just a couple months ago, the IFBB and MPC, or IFBB, excuse me, changed their rules and point system for how somebody can get on Olympia stage. So this is actually, what you just said is a topic I've been wanting to address because everybody thinks, oh, this is more fair. Really what it's about, the IFBB wanting to get more competitors doing more shows and require, because the way it used to be is this, right? So if you don't know how this works, if you're a pro like Aria, you win. So let's say this is the new season comes up right now, right? So we're heading into the new season let's say Arya goes out and he wins first place at his show, he would automatically be in Olympia for next year just because he took first place right away, right? Mm-hmm. Where now they're saying it doesn't matter if you win a show, it's the total amount of points throughout the year. So basically is telling all these competitors
to compete more often.
They're going to have to compete at least probably five shows a year.
That's not good.
No, wow. It's not at all, which is, it's really backwards thinking because it used to be like Mr. Olympia, so Jeremy Buendia automatically qualifies for next year. So he doesn't do any shows if he doesn't want to. If you're a winner, you're automatically in the next year. You don't got to do a single show until Olympia next year. You got to defend your title. That's all you got to prove, which I think is how it should be, right?
Like, sure.
So these guys that have qualified, like Arya, have to go this season, and they're going to have to do multiple show after show after show.
That is taxing.
It's very, very taxing
and
on the body.
And you see competitors, when they do this, their body starts to lose, it looks different. They lose sharpness. All of a sudden, it's not responding the way.
Yes.
It's just, so what would you say? How many shows do you think are healthy?
And you're right. That's the depends part, right? Because you're going to have a genetic anomaly too, like someone like Arya. Like Arya literally is doing a show probably every 2 months, and he keeps himself pretty.
He can maintain it.
Yeah, he maintains really well. He looks healthy, and he never lets himself get. He's always got abs. The guy's,
so he doesn't have to like extreme diet.
Yes, he doesn't have the extreme cut. It's just like he tightens some things up. And that when I was, so I did 4 shows in a year. That was the most I did in 1 year, and that felt like a ton, but it did make things a little bit easier to keep myself in good shape and not let myself rebound and go the other way. So there's,
otherwise
it
would,
because another one's coming right back,
right,
behind it.
Right, exactly. So I would literally, like, as soon as I get done with the show, I'd probably have a few days, maybe a week, where I could let myself kind of eat whatever, lay off the training a little bit, but then I was right into prep again. And so, I think there's some of that I think some of that stress, and this is something that comes from like Dr. Andy Galpin. I think some stress is very good for us. I think it's important.
Absolutely.
I think that, putting ourselves in these stress states, like even what we just did, the sprinting on the podcasting thing, and as stressed out as that was, and I know unhealthy it would be to run like that all the time, but I think there are some health benefits to actually pushing ourselves that way. So it's really more about, if you're going year after year, lots of shows like that, like, oh man, you're in for it.
At the end of the day, you just got to listen to your body. I have a client now that I'm working with, that I've been working with now for, I want to say 6 months, maybe about 6 months. And she competed 12 times over a period of a couple years. Like, I just did a lot of competitions.
Yeah.
And man, we are doing some serious repairing.
Yeah.
Like serious repairing to where I can't put her over 1,300 calories yet.
I made a business off of it. I literally had no intention to online coaching when I did it. No one's ever seen me put it on my Instagram. No one's ever heard me even mention it or talk about it. But I had a very successful business, and all I was helping was mostly women's bikini, men's physique, and bodybuilders. That as I was going through the circuit that I was meeting, that I just was getting terrible coaching. And I listened to him like, no, dude, that's not what you do. This is what you do. And so after a while, I was like, fuck, I just need to do this thing. And that full time, because there's a full time amount of, athletes that are going through this that are getting poor coaching. So I can imagine, because I know you're still doing that.
That's crazy.
All this restrictive talk makes me hungry.
Justin, stop.
How do you like
it? Why can't you wait till the end of the podcast?
Because it's right here in front of me.
I brought them.
I've been waiting for...
You guys have been talking shit forever about me bringing them. What do you think,
dude? You know what I mean? Oh, they're super tasty.
Right?
I'm loving it. What's in here? I know there's some walnuts and...
I'm Insta-storing it right now. It's literally an entire tray full of... cookies and brownies.
These are our Mind Pump Organifi cookies. Yeah, so this is...
Oh, this is not regular.
No, goofball.
I thought you were bringing these
are protein cookies and brownies.
God, I don't feel as bad.
Yeah, this is... So those that have been following me on Instagram have seen me post a story when we make these, and everyone's been giving me shit for not bringing them to you guys to try out.
So I'm going to try some right now.
Try out.
So what do we have here? We have...
So there's peanut... There's
peanut
a regular...
Peanut butter cookie.
There's an all peanut butter. So the bigger ones have walnuts in them.
Mm-hmm.
The smaller ones are just straight peanut butter, and then the chocolate is cocoa peanut butter brownies.
And you put protein powder in it.
All of them. They're all protein cookies.
Really?
Sweet. Yeah.
I'm going to be honest, audience. I'm not going to lie here. Just because we have a sponsor.
No, I brought you guys the ones that I know are the best.
Really, all right,
this is really good.
It doesn't taste like you have any protein powder in there. It tastes like a legit peanut butter cookie.
Like a cookie.
Yeah. No, it mixes really well, man.
Wow, that's really good.
Yeah.
That is really good.
So this, we've done, I don't know, we've probably done five different recipes or so. This is for sure one of my favorite recipes is this one. And I've shared it. So if you're
the protein cooks that well.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
You can't take, I would have never known.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I don't, it doesn't
just
even
blends
have an
right in.
Doesn't even have an aftertaste.
Mm-hmm.
Justin ate five already.
I did. You can't do this to me.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Right. I mean, the macros are pretty friendly. And I don't know them off the top of my head right now. I know, but there's not really much in it, man. It doesn't take that. With the peanut butter is the secret, I tell you what, because we've done like other flavored cookies.
Yeah, and I'm going to be honest. This one is, yeah, fantastic.
Right, it's the best one, I think, too. Believe it or not, these ones don't, but the Organifi green juice, you would be surprised how well it mixes with some stuff.
Oh, the mint chocolate you were saying?
Yeah, so we make a mint chocolate chip cookie, then we use the green juice, right? That's what turns it green. The cookie's green.
Huh.
And
that's such a good Christmas cookie if you think about
it,
right?
It is.
They're green.
I mean, it does have that mint aftertaste, so I can see how that might blend well.
It does blend well, man. It blends really well. Katrina tried it in a red velvet protein mix that we made. It was awful.
Oh,
it was awful. A lot of times she'll like surprise me. She won't tell me what she's doing, and she'll like try this. I'm like, what did you put in there? Why did you
That's an interesting combo.
Yeah, like it's like those flavors do not complement each other.
What do you say when you know it like tastes bad and you want to feel you're like that tastes interesting.
One thing about our relationship and it's always a little rough sometimes when I do it, but like I 100% I am not the guy that gives the white lie. Like if
does Katrina, she do the same thing to you?
Oh, absolutely.
That's good.
We have a very blunt, straightforward relationship. And if she makes something that is not good, I'll just like, honey, that tastes like shit. I don't know what you did.
So she'll straight up tell you like, yeah, you're stupid.
Oh,
you
no. You guys hear me say this all the time, but if you understood like how very, I mean, the radical honesty thing is so important, I think, in a relationship. It only took me fucking 30-something years to figure that out.
See, Courtney will know just by my portion size.
Like, how much
I see you don't like it. You know, yes, it's like a little tiny portion on my plate. Like, no, it's great. Everything's good.
But she's the first one too. She'll listen to an episode, and I'll be like, "Hey, did you listen to that episode?" And she's like, "Yeah, you sounded really stupid." I'm like, "Jeez, I got you." No. When you say, then she'll critique it. You know, when you said this, that, like, I don't know why. What were you thinking? I was like, and then I tried to defend myself.
So she never says that we said.
Yeah, well,
she never says something about me and Justin.
Never. Only good things.
Now you're lying.
No, I'm not.
We love Katrina.
Yeah.
She never says anything. Mm. That's why I try to blame it back on you. Well, that's because Sal said something to me. That's why I responded. That was a stupid response then. That's just. Yeah. So radical honesty.
All right. Our next question is from Allison W89. How do you think the holidays affect your mental and physical health, and what can we do to stay in a routine during the holidays?
So, you know what's funny about holidays that I've noticed?
Dude, just keep doing what you're doing right now.
It affects people in two general ways. Either people love holidays and it's a great time and it makes them feel so happy and they play Christmas music and everything's great. This is my girlfriend. This is my girlfriend. If you put Christmas music on for her during the holiday season, it doesn't matter what's going on, she's happy. She loves it. She loves decorating.
My wife's
she loves
the same way. Yeah.
I don't like the holidays for some reason. Mm. I'm starting to.
Do you know why?
You know, I'm trying to think why I don't like the holidays. I'm wondering if part of the reason why I don't like the holidays is because I was raised in the fitness industry, and for people who are in the business of fitness, holiday season sucks for business. It's just, it's the hardest time to run a gym.
Yeah.
It's the hardest time to hit your numbers, make money or whatever. People don't want to work out. Your gym is slow.
Clients flake on you.
I don't like cold weather. I don't like dark, you know, because I like the sun when it's out. So I think I've associated it all with that. And then on top of it, you know, when I was married, my ex-wife had a family member that was very close to her pass away. Like the day before Thanksgiving. So for years after Thanksgiving
that kinda stays with you.
Yeah, so it stayed with us on that. So, but I'm starting to like it again. I'm starting to like the holidays again. But here's the thing with the holidays, I'll say, when it comes to your physical and mental health. It's all in how you view it. You know, the people who think of the holidays as a negative thing, it's going to be bad. It's going to be bad for your mental health. For people who really enjoy it and love it and enjoy the people around them, it's going to be very good. So it's really up on you. And as far
yeah, but as, you say that so fucking lightly, like it's easy. Because let me tell you something. This has been a huge struggle for me for fucking 30 years of my life.
You don't like the holidays.
Well, I try to. I've been working at it for a long time. You know, it's tough when you had a childhood like I did with the shit that I went through, which most people that have listened to the show for a long time know what that is. And holidays were the worst. So, I mean, our family was fucking chaotic year round, but the holidays were always worse because that's when my family would be the most stressed because you got fucking four kids, we're broke. We can't, you know, it's like trying to figure out how can we afford to get a Christmas tree. Plus, you gotta get all these kids gifts, and then it's like it was. And then as a kid, I remember getting money and stuff like that from other family members sent, and we had to turn that money over to my parents to feed us or to get the Christmas tree or to do something like that. And so, and when you're fucking 8 years old, you don't process that like a normal adult mm-hmm. would. Like as an adult now, I'd have probably empathy for my parents, and mm-hmm. it's not. As a kid, I'm mad.
Yeah.
As a kid, I'm angry. As a kid, I didn't get anything, so I'm pissed off. And then my parents take my money. I was like, this is fucked up. If I was on my own, mm-hmm. at least be able to keep my own money. So that's kind of your attitude, right? Yeah. So I carried that for a very long time. And then in my adulthood, I would always I didn't pick up on it till later that I would struggle around this time of year, and especially if I was in a relationship, and I'm awful at like doing the gift thing and doing thoughtful things around the holiday. What I am good at doing is year round, like best boyfriend ever, right? I'm getting buy stuff for my girl, spoil the shit out of her. If I miss anything, it's a fucking holiday or a birthday. And it's because I have trained.
You just block
well,
yourself.
What's harder for you, giving the gifts or receiving?
Oh, receiving.
Yeah.
Receiving is.
I've noticed that.
Receiving is.
I like this about you.
Yeah.
So
I don't have to buy shit for you.
Yeah, no. So
it's for you, by the way.
No, so it used to get so bad. This is real talk, right? So you guys know being trainers for many years, once you establish relationships with a lot of these clients, they love you like family and they buy you stuff. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I'd have clients that would buy me gifts. And finally, I'd get a client would be like, hey, you know, I just bought you like a $2,000 gift and you just like no big deal. It's like, and then I had to explain my whole story, right? And, you know, they would try and work on like, you know, you know, try this and try that and giving me books to read and all this shit. And none of it would help. And what I'd find would happen would I would end up faking emotion to keep them happy. You know, they would give me a gift and I know, fuck, all right, Adam, act surprised, act excited. And I would be faking this. And you guys know me, I can't do that very well. Like that's not my style. So I finally got to a point where I told everybody, everything from my family, everybody, all I want for Christmas, all I want for my birthday is toilet paper. And so this was a big thing that went on for years where I would go
wipe that ass.
This was the thing was. I can't, I buy the things that I want, I work hard so I could buy the things that I want for myself. So that I don't really want, like if I feel like I there's not like these gifts that I have a list of like, God,
there's
I wish
a story
I,
behind toilet paper too, though.
Well, yeah, there's story. Of course there's stories behind.
It's not just because.
Why don't you ask for wet wipes? I mean, that's what you use anyway.
Well, that's part of that too. So they come in. So when we were kids, part of being poor too, like I'll never forget this. Fuck, man, I hated this. I hated coming home from school, right? You know, to take your fucking day shit, right? After
school. The one that you're holding at
school. Yes, yes. I'm running home from school. Like everyone's had this, right? If you went to school and you're waiting to sit at your own toilet, you don't want to take a shit at school. School shits are terrible.
No way, man.
Right. So
some kid's going to bust the door open.
I don't know how many times in high school and elementary or junior high, whatever, running home from school to get home to take my day shit and fucking no toilet paper or like a stack of McDonald's napkins, you know, is what I'm wiping my ass with. And, you know, I just,
that's rough, man.
So people that don't know this about me, this is where the baby wipe fetish came from and why that was so important to me. Years, all I asked for was toilet paper. So every year I do still get this from all my family and close friends. They know this about me. So I've always got a year of supply of toilet paper I never had to buy toilet paper. And I get excited because I think, you know, these people really know me and I think it's funny and it's this great. So it's been something that's been going on as a tradition in my family and in my small circle of friends like that know this.
I'm
going to
buy
me.
You the most expensive, rare, like collectible toilet paper of all time.
Like gold.
I got to find it. Yeah. I'm going to find
it. It's got to exist somewhere.
Yeah, it's got to be like, it's made out of like yak.
So this being said, I think this, what's extremely important is if you're somebody who struggles with this, and this is what was hard for me was communicating this. So when I was younger, I was just I would avoid it. Like, oh, I don't want to go. I don't want to go to any of these fucking holiday things. I don't. Yeah. I just don't want to be around it. Like, well, if you're once you become a grown ass adult and you get married or you get in a relationship, eventually you're gonna have to do some of these family things. So it's taken a lot of practice and exercise for me to do it. It's also very important to have a partner like I have now who knows this about me, and that I've communicated that to her, that your family is amazing. They love the holidays. You guys all, I love to be a part of it, but I just want you to know that inside, what you don't see is it's work and effort for me to do this. And it still is. And I don't know if it'll ever completely not be work. I've gotten better at being able to, you know, just relax and have a good time and enjoy the holidays. But for many, many years, man, I would just leave. Katrina would have a hard time. This was early on in our relationship. Her family, huge. Everybody comes over. They all spend the night. Like, this, still this day, everybody, all the family comes together, sleeping in sleeping bags on the floor the night before.
Oh, man.
And I know someone's listening right now, out. Like, yes, this is my family. And lots of families do this type of shit, right? Not me, dude. Like, no. I mean, I'm the guy who didn't spend the night at someone else, a woman's house, till I was 30. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So I'm fucking not spending the night at your mom's floor. You know what I'm saying? Are you kidding me? So that was really tough. And so there's definitely a compromise that she has. A lot of times I'll leave the event, but the whole family knows, and they know now. But boy, was it a struggle.
Oh, dude.
Early years, for sure.
Very similar. Like, I, because Courtney's family very much gets into this. And you know, after every present, they want to hug.
Yes, that's her family. Oh, after every present, everybody has to
do I have
up.
To hug?
Like, get up,
every
hug
time. Like, it's just awkward. I'm not a big hugger. You know, to begin with. So that's like, you know, yeah, cool, thanks. I just want to give them like the bump or something, you know, and like move on. But, and then what we do now, and I'm trying to actually address this myself, because like, you know, she loves the same thing with coming over and sleeping. So we'll have a couple of the cousins stay over at our house like afterwards. And then, you know, her sisters and all that stuff. And at first I was just like, there's like too many people in my house. You know, I can't stand like all this like extra energy and stuff. But I've had to just check myself on it and go with it, you know.
You know what we sound like? A bunch of Scrooges.
Just a bunch of
assholes. No, see, now you say that. But then like one of the things that I found out about myself about, well, it's now 8 or 9 years ago, maybe 10 now, was I adopted a family. And every year I do this. So I have a place that I call right at Thanksgiving. They give me a family, and then I do Christmas for a family. That has become extremely rewarding and enjoyable for me to do. And I love that part of the holidays. There's something about finding this family who's in extreme need. Like, they just, I mean, like.
And they only, the things they ask for is what trips me out.
Oh, yeah. Oh, this is what you, exactly.
A Christmas tree, wrapping paper.
I could go to CVS and buy the toys and everything like that, right? Just buy, and the kids are just screaming and crying. This was back when I had my pickup truck, and I would load the whole thing up just with toys. And with them, it's about volume. It's not like little rich kids here, you know, fucking that are spoiled. Yeah. It's about how big the gift is, or the $400 gift, or the $1,000 gift for that. With them, it's like just things they get to open. They're just so excited they get to open stuff. So I would just get tons of like small gifts, and you unload it and then fill up this house just full of stuff and watch these kids, man. It was just, it's been amazing to see that. And it's also been good for me, because it also reminds me, like, I didn't have it that bad. Like, I had it that bad, and yeah, it was tough. Mm-hmm. What about that? Like, there's so many more people that had it way worse than I did. So that's helped me stop being such a little bitch about the holidays and having a hard time, is seeing other people that are in way more need than I was ever.
So that's all the mental side. I think we've strayed a little bit from the question. But as far as like the physical side, you know, just getting out and being active, hiking, doing stuff.
Yeah,
like,
we just
staying on your routine.
Yeah, just work out.
We just talked about this, though.
We did.
2 episodes ago, we talked about the holiday thing. And I think too many people put too much pressure on, you know, staying fit through that. And I think that's, Sal said it really well, that's what causes that binging. It's like, you're with family. If you're eating well and training year round, fucking Thanksgiving and Christmas are not going to make you obese. You know, you're not going to get obese in 1 or 2 days.
And I've tried. It doesn't do it.
But having that balance, right?
I mean, mom's fudge kind of packs it on.
Whoa.
I'll be honest.
Fudge packer?
Whoa. You just put that together.
That was an accident.
Was you. Yeah. No, it wasn't me.
All right, next question is from Trev Lucy. Have recent CrossFit guests changed your minds about CrossFit and its impact?
Totally.
Justin.
Bro, you know what? Yes, they have,
no,
dude.
Not at all.
Of course they have. When you meet people, well, fine, I'll talk for myself then, you fucking hard-headed. When we've met with people like the guys from Barbell Shrugged or Beyond the Barbell or Kalipa, Kelly Starrett, when you talk to these people about the business of CrossFit, how they coach in their gyms, what they know about exercise and training, especially the guys from Beyond the Barbell, I'm realizing that because CrossFit was a loose affiliation, it just everybody did it. And what you're seeing now is, and they've all said this, that the explosion of CrossFit has slowed down quite a bit and is now plateaued because all the bad coaches, all the bad programming is falling off. Those gyms are not successful, and all the good people are succeeding, and you're starting to see this morph into something that's a little bit better. And they even said themselves that there's the sport of CrossFit, and then there's a way you work out for fitness, and it's totally different. So for me personally, it's changed a lot. As far as CrossFit, the sport is concerned, it's awesome. It's still awesome. I always thought it was awesome. It was the whole CrossFit boxes for fitness that I had an issue with just because the programming I thought was terrible. But there's good coaches out there that are doing good things, and it looks like it's moving in that direction. Then we had the Girls Gone Wad, the host Julie Bauer from Paleo OMG. They're all CrossFitters, and they're talking about different types of programming, correctional exercise, not doing the Olympic lifts to fatigue. So it's changing my mind. It has changed my mind.
No, definitely. I've definitely softened up. Having all these guests on there and hearing their story and their drive and motivation going into it, to make an impact and change. And I get that.
Don't be a pussy. Let me finish.
Let me finish. It's still stupid. It's really stupid. It's not, I don't consider it a sport like you guys do. I definitely appreciate, the taxing nature of it. It's really hard, but for me, it just looks like a big watered down show, like this gauntlet of fucking like hurt myself. So, I mean, that's never going to go away. You can't convince me otherwise. Every sport has its own appeal. And for me, I'm just not attracted to it. So, that's my own opinion. And I I get that, people are into it and shit. But, for me, there's still part of me that's like a purist, like sport athlete. And I know I'm getting a lot of shit for this because everybody considers it a sport and it's like legit, and I get that. But I appreciate people in it. I appreciate their motivations towards it. It's like, do you like to watch golf?
No, I don't.
There you go. I don't like to watch CrossFit. It's the same thing.
Okay. I don't know if my minds have changed or our minds have changed about CrossFit. I don't think it's really changed. I think we've met all the people you rattle off. I mean, I was around it early. I mean, we talked about that with Kalipa. I remember watching him in the parking lot before anyone knew who he was and out there doing the first one in Milpitas before the games even came out. So we were fucking around with CrossFit well before anybody knew what it was. And as a trainer who had already been training for a good solid 5 years plus by that time, I right away saw that this is not like for the average Jane or Joe to get in shape. I've already trained at this point probably hundreds of people. And I'm thinking when someone teaches me a new modality or a new thing in training, right away I compute that with, okay, how does this translate to my clients? How can I use this, with the clients I have? And just, it wasn't applicable at all. It was not something that transferred over to training the people I was training. Maybe I had one or two clients, and I did. I had one or two clients that I could train that way and loved it, and it was fine for them. They were athletic enough to handle those movements and doing things like that. But for the most part, it just didn't apply to the people that I was helping. So I right away viewed it as a sport. Right away I saw it and thought, this is a fucking cool sport, man. It's like football. It's like basketball. It's just with weights. It's just nothing we've seen before that where someone decided to make a sport out of lifting. And so I've learned.
I don't like those sports at all.
And now that we've had a chance to interview all these guys, what it is you have people like everybody you just named and that we've interviewed on the show that are trying to make it better, right, for a group. But at the end of the day, there will never be a group setting class that will be superior to one-on-one coaching. Because as humans, we are all so fucking individual and unique. It's the reason why it's so difficult and why it was so hard for us to create a program or programs that we put out online, because we knew damn well that when we create something that it's not ideal for every single person, which is exactly how when we released it, it was like, listen, here is a blueprint, you know, and a foundation for some general rules of these are movements that you should be incorporating into your training, and this is how you should structure it and undulate it. So that part is true, but then as far as it being able to mold to the individual, that part is extremely important because we're all so fucking different. Mm-hmm. So no, it hasn't changed my mind. I've always liked it. The reason why we brought people on, because we like all those people, think they're very intelligent, smart, and doing great things for the CrossFit community. But it's still, I would never, if I had a client who said, called me up and said, Adam, I've never worked out before. I want to get in shape. You know, I was thinking about doing CrossFit. What do you think? I would say no. Hmm. I would say no. Let me help you out. And I would tell them, I would assess them and see where they're at, and then probably give them a recommendation based off of that. So that's where I've always stood on it. And I've never been like bitter about it or been hard about it. I know we came out early on for the show. We knew that if we took a stance against CrossFit and said why we don't CrossFit, we knew that would cause attention. But at the end of the day, all of my good buddies are competitors and do that stuff, and I was around it since day one. So I've always had an open mind to the sport. And I think if you like it and it works well for you and you don't get hurt and you enjoy it and you stay in good shape and you know how to back off the intensity to keep yourself safe year round and do that, then who the fuck am I to tell you that's not good for you? Like, who, you know, do it.
Yeah, do whatever you want. Yeah, get crazy.
Next up is Josh Dobo Dobson. Your most embarrassing sex story.
Wow.
Who threw this one up there?
Dude, this guy over here.
What? First of all, I didn't want to do it. Adam was like, do it, man. Put it up there. We need to do it.
It's been a long time.
It's all good.
We strayed away from these type of questions for a long time. And we've been having a lot of people on the forum pop up like, man, I miss the old mind pump when you guys used to go off the rails and talk about vaginas for an entire hour and stuff. So where are those days?
Summon the old.
So Sal threw this out there, and I thought, man, let's talk about some embarrassing sex stories. Do you have one off the top of your head?
I do.
Let me hear it.
I do, and it's going to be more embarrassing for my girlfriend. Sorry, babe. It's when we first kind of started hanging out, and when I first met her, it was shortly after I had finally done with my ex. So I'm out. I didn't want to meet anybody. It just happened. Totally fell for each other very strongly. So shortly after that, we're sitting down and we're having this really good deep conversation, and she'll still argue this to this day, because I bring this up to her and she's like, that's not what happened. This is what happened. It's exactly what happened. I reach over and grab her hand to pull her closer to me to kiss me, because I'm going to give her a kiss. And I think she misunderstood me grabbing her hand to pull her closer with me grabbing her hand to put it on my dick. So I grab her hand. I pull. I pull her over, and she just grabs it.
Perfect. That is not embarrassing. That's like something went wrong.
Embarrassing because when I tell the story, she's like, "Dude, what the fuck?" I grab her hand, and she does it, and I look at her like, "Whoa!" And she looks at me like, "What?" And I'm like, "I was just gonna give you a kiss." And she's like, "Well, you wanted me." And she's like, "But you put my hand." And I said, "No, I was just trying to." And then we had this whole like debate about it, and then we made out anyway. That's my embarrassing
story. Is that as far as you can go?
Yeah.
Yeah, I have something more embarrassing.
Come on, man.
Maybe I'll.
All right.
That's like PG shit.
All right. So
right
I gotta paint the story here. I'm 23 years old. I'm 3 years into personal training.
I know what you're gonna say.
I had my house for a year. So I'm making good money. I'm a trainer. I'm fit. I'm 23. I'm full of piss and vinegar and just think I'm on top of the world, right? And I like to date girls that were older than I was. So I was chasing after this 29-year-old girl that was French, Vietnamese, and Filipino.
What a great story.
And God, she was fucking bad. She was bad, right?
Oh,
and all the guys in the gym loved her and were always chasing after her. And you know, I was slowly talking to her over time, and I knew that this girl, like, everybody wanted her, so I couldn't just like hit on her all the time, right? So I slowly like worked my game with her, and by worked my game, I just talked to this girl, like, and I didn't try and pick up on her right away. I just got to know her, And, you know, we'd start flirting over time. And then eventually you could tell there was this, like, sexual tension. But she used to talk shit to me, like, you know, you're not ready for me. Like, I'm a grown-ass woman.
I'm on another level.
You're a little boy, yeah. Right? And I'm thinking in my head, like, bullshit. Like,
whatever.
Right.
Yeah. I'm ready for you.
I got skills.
What are you going
to
do?
So, long story short, I get her, and she's coming back to my house. I get her to come back to my house. And we're driving to my house. And it's already like on in the car. Like it's like I'm head, like I'm just like, oh, I'm so excited right now, right? And we pull into my garage and we're messing around in the garage and like already clothes are getting pulled off. I'm going upstairs with her. We go into my master bedroom and we get in there and she like closes the door right away, wham, slams it. And then I'm standing at the edge of my bed and she walks over and she goes, poof. And she pushes me right in the chest. And I'm like, oh, shit, this is about to go down. And then she just grabs my pants, starts unzipping them. And I'm sitting laying back going like, fuck, yeah, here we go. Right? I'm so excited right now. And so she unzips, rips my pants all the way off and down. And then she goes like, and I'm pretty sure that I'm going to get head right now, but I'm not. She grabs my ankles.
Oh,
and
it's
she,
a little more south. Huh?
She tilts me up even further, and she
scoops you.
She goes straight for my asshole.
Woo!
And I'm 23 right now, and my salad has not been tossed ever. And I did not know that this was like a first date thing that you do.
Wow.
So
not typically.
So what was so embarrassing was she was so hot, she was so bad. I wanted her so bad. I was of course ready for the moment. But the moment she did that, it tickled so bad. I was so uncomfortable. I completely lost my heart on. I was so embarrassed. I couldn't get it up after that.
Did
like
you
it was
giggle just, like?
Oh no, it was just weird. It's not my thing for sure. Like it definitely was not my thing. I know Sal likes that type of stuff.
Oh my god, he's always got to throw that out there. Dude, she
been in heaven,
it.
Huh?
She did.
You weren't ready for her.
I wasn't.
She was right,
and maybe that was what she was trying to prove to me, that I was just not ready. And now, for all those that were wondering, like I came back later on, made up for everything, and it was all good. But it was definitely one of the most embarrassing moments for me. I was not ready for that, and 23 years old, getting a salad tossed.
I can't really top that. You know, that's amazing.
Can't top that salad.
No, I can't get into that. Mine was more of a mix of like kind of like a horrific like shit situation, and you know, like I was just dating Courtney. It was like the very beginning. It was like maybe like we'd done it a handful of times, you know, and I just got this apartment with this guy. I had to get out of my house because it was like, I can't take her to my parents' house. This is fucking like, I'm a loser, you know, I need to get a new place. And so I shacked up with this guy who has a house, and he also had his kid every now and then, like every other weekend. And so this kid would like come in, and every now and then he'd like say hi or whatever, and like I was friends with him and stuff. And so I brought Courtney back one time, and so we're up there, you know, in the room and about to get down to business and stuff. And you know, we're kind of getting hot and heavy, and then my stomach started just and she was like, what was that? I was like, wow, nothing. But I just like kept trying to like drive and you know, keep going, like, you know, press on, like I have to perform. And it just kept going. It's getting louder. And she's like, I don't know. This is like maybe the sixth time, right? So I'm like, oh shit. Like, it's like, I think, you know, something might get down. And then it got to the point where I was like, oh my god, like something's squeezing out. And I had to like pinch super hard. Thankfully, the bathroom was like right next door.
Wait, you had to like leave.
You had to stop halfway through.
I had to leave mid bank. I stopped. Okay. And she was like, wait, like what? I was like, I just have to, you know, I'll be right back.
I have to go take a shit.
Went right next door. Like, so I should have probably gone downstairs. Like that would have been a smart thing to do. But no, I went right. There was a sharing wall.
Oh my God.
And so I'm sitting on this toilet. And I'm like, like the worst, like most explosive shit I've ever had in my life, right? And like I was like, oh my god, I was like so embarrassed. And I was like, oh god, thank god she can't hear me, you know. And I'm like laughing to myself, like like it was like so loud and vicious, you know. And I get back in, and like Courtney's like sitting on the bed looking at me with this big smile, and I was like, oh shit, she heard everything.
Oh my god.
She was looking at me, she's like, are you okay? Like, you're right. And I was like,
and in your head, you're like, can we finish now?
Yeah, I was like, I haven't got off yet. Yeah, keep going.
Oh
yeah.
My
she's
god.
Like, no.
Oh my god.
And then you married her.
Yeah.
And then you married her. Like this, but she is down.
She knew what she was in for.
She is down.
She knew what she was in for. I got that inside. So
straight wife you up right there. Yeah.
And that kid walked in on us one time too. So that was the other story. That was awkward.
One of yours?
No. This was the kid that was like, he was he wasn't supposed to be there, but like every other weekend, and then this became a frequent thing, and he was coming in because I had showed him, I had a Game Boy, and I was like, you know, I ended up giving it to him, and he was like, hey, thanks for the Game Boy. Ah, like he's watching us bang.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, so those are my
two. Have you had your kids walk in yet?
Not yet. Thankfully. Oh. I mean, we got sneaky, dude. We were in the kitchen.
You get smart
while they're watching TV.
You have to,
man.
You have to when you have kids.
That's you got to do what you got to do.
I don't have any, man.
It's kind of exciting.
Yeah, it is.
I got thrilling. My kid walked in. I forgot to lock the door, and thank God it was the beginning of sex, so we were still under the covers. And my daughter walks in, and we just stop. You know, we're just like
bear hug.
Yeah.
I'm wrestling.
We're just stopping. Like we're just hugging. We're just hugging under the covers. My daughter's asking me all these questions. I'm like, yeah.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Little does she know.
Oh yeah.
I'm inside.
What's underneath? I'm inside.
Anyway.
Staying warm.
So new thing we're gonna try out. I'm gonna drop, or one of us will drop, a knowledge bomb at the end of one of our episodes every week. So I think I'll drop the first one. These are short. These are going to be short, like 4 minute, 5 minute little tips for fitness or for anything else. We think you need
just
a tip on.
Just giving the tip.
So the first one is going to be on trigger sessions. Now, this is something that is in one of our programs, MAPS Anabolic. But here's how you use a trigger session. Real quick. On your days off, do some very light pumping type exercises. So if you hit chest on Monday and your chest is really sore, on Tuesday, do some light band, flies, some light push-ups. Just get a good squeeze, get a good burn, get a little bit of a pump in the muscle. What it does is it maintains that muscle building signal. It keeps it elevated. It also facilitates recovery. You'll actually find that you recover faster because you did this. Trigger sessions, if you do them consistently, are a game changer. It's a great way to increase frequency of stimulation without.
What would you
really
recommend the intensity? Because I know that the most common thing that I see when people try to apply this to their routine is they overdo it and then they create more damage.
It's not a workout. You're just trying to get a pump. You're just getting a little bit of a pump in the muscle and squeeze. Think of maintaining that anabolic signal without creating muscle damage. So do this, again, on the days off. Do it frequently. So you could do it like 2 or 3 times that day and pick weak body parts. Do it for several body parts. Be consistent with it. You'll notice within a week, literally within 1 week, you'll notice changes in your body. That's how effective they are. And again, it's found primarily in our MAPS anabolic program. If you want more information, by the way, you can go to mindpumpmedia.com. Also, YouTube. Our YouTube is on fire right now. We post 365 plus videos a year. That's more than anybody in the universe. At least I think so. It's Mind Pump TV
if
on
not,
YouTube.
We're going to say that.
On YouTube.
We'll claim that all day.
Subscribe today.
Thank you for listening to Mind Pump. If your goal is to build and shape your body, dramatically improve your health and energy, and maximize your overall performance, check out our discounted RGB Super Bundle at mindpumpmedia.com. The RGB Super Bundle includes MAPS Anabolic, MAPS Performance, and MAPS Aesthetic. 9 months of phased expert exercise programming designed by Sal, Adam, and Justin to systematically transform the way your body looks, feels, and performs. With detailed workout blueprints and over 200 videos, the RGB Super Bundle is like having Sal, Adam, and Justin as your own personal trainers, but at a fraction of the price. The RGB Super Bundle has a full 30-day money-back guarantee, and you can get it now plus other valuable free resources at mindpumpmedia.com. If you enjoy this show, please share the love by leaving us a 5-star rating and review on iTunes and by introducing Mind Pump to your friends and family. We thank you for your support, and until next time, this is Mind Pump.